Yeah, so after this vague message I got from William Osman at the beginning of this year, I landed on a list of more than 50 other awesome YouTube creators and agreed to attend an event nobody really knew what it's going to become. This dubious event turned out to become OpenSauce, a playground for tinkerers held in the beautiful San Francisco Bay Area in July 2023, organized by William Osman and his amazing team. This seriously became one of the most impressive events I've ever attended, and it allowed me to meet great like-minded tinkerers and the smartest and kindest YouTube creators. Oh, and did I say we even ended up at Mark Robers CrunchLabs? Let's find out more. Guten Tag, everybody. I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. Okay, but let's start at the beginning. Thanks to PCBWay, who sponsored my trip to San Francisco, I drove to Zurich in Switzerland and took a plane to California. OpenSauce was taking place on the second weekend in mid-July this year, and since I wanted to make sure I'm not totally jet-lagged, I arrived already 2 days earlier. Here, I met up with Jon from Proper Printing, who was fearing the same fate. So we did our best to adjust to the 9 hours of time difference, and of course had to do all of the touristy stuff that tourists tend to do. We walked through half of the city, and then even rented bikes to cycle over the iconic Golden Gate Bridge. We also had the amazing opportunity to visit Autodesk's Technology Center on Pier 9, which is a place filled with super talented people and amazing machines where they work on impressive technology projects. But then it was time for OpenSauce. Will and his team started with the planning of the event at the end of 2022, and even though it's impressive what they were able to achieve in this small amount of time, this also caused some issues. Honestly, I talked to many other YouTube creators, sponsors and viewers just like you about OpenSauce, and nobody could really wrap their head around what this event is going to be like, simply because it had never happened. And this held back many from buying tickets for the event in the beginning, and I think even sponsors for putting money into the event. Will told several times that OpenSauce lost a ton of money, which he paid out of his own pocket, and I can't really express my gratitude about how amazing it is that he still pulled through with it, because OpenSauce turned out to be more than impressive. Friday was the first day of the event, which started with a chill dinner on an old World War II ship that was right next to the event site at Pier 35. This was the opportunity to get to know other creators and exhibitors, take pictures with some of the VIP ticket holders, and browse over the venue site without the huge crowds of the following days. Saturday was the first public day of the event. The tickets were fully sold out and people were just flooding into the building. I've been on other shows before, but this was just next level. I seriously underestimated the size of the event and the amount of people, security staff and whatnot that made sure everything ran smoothly. Let's first talk about a couple of projects I've seen there before I tell you how I raced Michael Reeves and how I ended up at Mark Robers CrunchLabs, where I almost won $10,000. So I just said that I underestimated the size of the event and the things that happened all in parallel. So I was only able to cover some projects properly and probably missed 90%. If you've been to OpenSauce, let me know in the comments what you enjoyed the most. The first guys I stumbled over actually flew in from Europe as well. They're CPSDrone from Poland, which is an acronym for Custom Printed Submarine Drone. They make 3D printed underwater vehicles, and when I walked by, they just demonstrated one of their models in the water of the bay. They started building their first ones when they were still in high school because they loved 3D printing and were intrigued by the idea of underwater drones. The drones they make are tethered to transfer video and control signals, but unfortunately, the water of the bay was really cloudy and I wasn't able to see a lot on the video stream. It was still amazing to see the level of maneuverability they were able to achieve with all of the propellers around the vehicle. It was really interesting to talk to them about the challenges of getting 3D prints watertight, especially for the pressures at depth and how they ended up encasing the electronics in an acrylic tube. If you want to check them out, there's a link to their website and their drone building course in the description. From big remote controlled submarines to very small remote controlled submarines. This right here is a drone that you can swallow and that will swim around your stomach. Pill cameras have already been around for decades. What NDRTX is making differently is that the PillBot is actuated so it can be freely controlled by the doctor to diagnose a patient. So you first drink a good amount of water so that you have a clear fluid in your stomach, and then swallow the pill. There's a propulsion system in the back that lets then the doctor dive the sub around your stomach. The idea is that you get the PillBot shipped and swallow it in the comfort of your home. A doctor can then control and diagnose you remotely from basically anywhere. Honestly, if they had given me the chance to try it out myself, I'd love to see how my stomach looked on the inside. How the PillBot gets out of your body again is, by the way, something that you can try to imagine yourself. You all know that complex maker projects always consist out of different components, yet not everyone has a huge shop at home with 3D printers, CNC routers, or tools to make circuit boards. Sometimes you just need a part machined from metal, printed in a high-performance polymer, or a professional and complex PCB made for your electronics. In such a case, I highly recommend you to check out PCBWay, because you might not have known that, but they can easily and affordably assist you when you need a variety of parts. PCBWay doesn't only make PCBs, they do CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, injection molding, and lots of different types of 3D printing, including metal printing using selective laser melting. So I needed this part right here, for example, printed from stainless steel. I simply went to PCBWay, uploaded the design, selected the material and quantity, and got an instant quote. They then manufactured the parts within a couple of days and shipped them to me so I could continue refining my new product. Try it out yourself and you'll be amazed what they are able to make for you. Check out PCBWay using the link below. OpenSauce wasn't just booths of people showing off their stuff, there were also many other fun things happening on the side, like combat robots, a robot tug of war, or power wheel racing, where I participated, which was super fun. So these guys have a maximum budget of 500 bucks to buy and modify a power wheel with new motors, batteries, and everything that makes these kids' toys perform as well as possible. I was part of a creator race, and each of us got a ride provided. I was racing against Hexa, my fellow German woodworking YouTuber Marius Hornberger, and a ton of other guys. I was doing really well in the beginning and had a battle with Michael Reese for several laps until, unfortunately, my battery slowly started dying and I had to be brought to the pit. A sad ending for me, yet still a ton of fun. But back to the maker booths. I have to admit, we, and with me I mean primarily my wife, have quite an addiction for tea drinking, mugs, and pottery. So I was super stoked to see what Chris from Pratt Ceramics showed off. He developed tools and the process for making double-walled, beautiful ceramic mugs so that your drinks stay hot longer. Chris builds his machine with a combination of CNC routed parts and those beautiful on-brand purple 3D prints. Making a cup is a multi-stage process. First, pours the liquid clay called slip into the outer plaster mold. The plaster absorbs some of the moisture, solidifying the clay at the walls. Then he puts in the inner mold, creating the actual cup, which creates the hollow internal structure after pouring out the excess. He talked a bit how challenging it is to dial in the process that the parts are not too delicate when demolding, yet also not too hard that they don't release from the plaster mold anymore. After drying, the parts are fired and glazed, resulting in these beautiful pieces that are not your standard mug. Next to Chris Booth was Russ, who works with a similar material, but also doesn't just do regular clay printing. Chris prints what he calls familial, but unique shapes. Familial means that if you put your parts on a shelf, they look as they belong together, but they're not the same. He wrote software that creates these similar, but always unique parts, which is a very interesting touch if you, on the one hand, want to make art utilizing a 3D printer, but on the other hand, have this kind of handcrafted look. These parts are also fired twice, and it was really interesting to see how the thick glaze that he uses fully smooths over the layer lines that he prints with a 2mm nozzle. On my way to the next booth, I quickly got stopped by Alex Feel, who made the Wiggle Lens version 2. This is a lens consisting out of three individual lenses that take images from slightly different perspectives in one shot. If you then play the side-by-side images in a loop, you get this 3D look, which is really neat. He took these Wigglegrams with a ton of creators, and you should definitely check them out. At the next booth, I saw an impressive 3D printing process developed by a research team from UC Berkeley. This is computer axial lithography. In this process, a model is not printed layer by layer, but all at once. A vial contains a photosensitive resin, very similar to what we use in our MSLA printer. While the resin container is spinning, a UV projector basically shines individual images for each angle through the liquid. These images are pre-calculated with high-intensity light at locations where you have material and no light for empty areas. This way, you can cure resin at arbitrary locations in the cylinder, forming your final part. This might sound a bit familiar to you because this is a very similar process to how a CT scan works, yet only in reverse. Since the prints are cured in resin, you don't need any support structure. Unfortunately, the printing process heats the resin up at the location where it cures, which makes them more buoyant, potentially ruining your part. This is why their standard resin is very thick in consistency, so that not much movement can happen in the 20 seconds it takes to print one part. Yet when there's no gravity, there's also no buoyancy. So they already tested this printer on a 0G flight, where they can use low viscosity resins for more details and very specific applications. Another great thing about this technology is that it's open source and you can find CAD data, software and algorithms all on their GitHub. Printing a resin object all at once also doesn't get rid of working with these sticky and smelly substances. This is why I had an awesome chat with Stefan, great name by the way, who built a prototype of an automatic glove donning machine. So a machine that helps you to put on gloves. The gloves are put on carts and then grabbed by a robot arm that loads everything into the machine. An upper aperture makes sure that the lip of the glove is folded over the holder on the lower aperture. This one then expands and it allows you to easily slip into the glove without needing a second hand. Once your hand is inserted, the machine releases the glove and you're fully set up. Not everything ran smoothly, but this machine was already going for a day straight, which took a toll on some of the mechanisms. Yet it was still great to see the concept working. If this prototype gets refined more, I can see a ton of applications for it. And not only if one of your hands is already messy, but also if someone maybe only has one hand at all? Besides all of these booths, there were also a ton of talks on the main stage, where dumb people discussed, smart people talked, and I also had the chance to be on stage with Angus from Maker's Muse, Joel Telling, and Joseph Prusha, chatting and answering questions on 3D printing and the future of the technology. The event closed to the public on Sunday, and I only heard positive feedback from the visitors and creators. So even though the event didn't make any money, and probably also because of that, there will be an open source 2024. Early bird tickets are already on sale, and I heard rumors that they want to make it bigger next year, and move it to somewhere where accommodation is a bit more affordable than San Francisco. So if you have the chance to visit, please do. It will be an experience you won't forget. For many of the creators, this amazing event didn't end yet, because on Monday, Mark Rober invited us to have brunch at CrunchLabs. So basically, brunch labs? The CrunchLabs building is where Mark's team of talented and creative people come up with cool projects and toys for his subscription box that they ship out every month. And honestly, for me, it was almost unreal being at that place and seeing what they do and how they do it. We not only had the chance to mess around a bit with all of the attractions, but also had the famous once-in-a-lifetime chance to win $10,000 at the tennis ball cannon. After signing the wall, you get one shot to hit a tennis ball into a tiny hole on the other side of the room. Well, I missed the first shot, but I have to proudly say I did it on the third try. Which won me nothing. Anyways, it was amazing to see how CrunchLab has the charm of a makerspace with all of the tools and toys you can imagine and that they use to bring their ideas into reality, which are then shipped to kids all around the world, inspiring and teaching them how to think like an engineer in a fun way. It was a great experience and I'm very grateful that Mark invited us and even got me a Fat Gus for my daughter. Even though this weekend in San Francisco was super exhausting, it was just another great opportunity to talk to so many like-minded and amazing people. And if I'm super honest, this was also an unreal experience for me, because I was able to spend a weekend with my rock stars, with the creators I've sometimes been watching for a decade, and be one of them. All the commitment, sweat, blood and tears of the last years culminated in this amazing experience. And this is definitely not only because of the passion that I have for all of this, but also because of you, with your interest in my work and watching me what I make, and I sincerely thank you for this. Please leave a like if you enjoyed the coverage of open source and subscribe if you want to see what I come up with back home in my studio, because after the final day of chilling out in the Bay Area, I had to fly back home.